Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Well, I'm Rishit Jain, and I'm working with delivery as a product manager with the data sciences team. And my charter includes, so delivery has a bunch of data capabilities. And my charter includes how to productize some of these algorithms so that we are able to gain business outcomes out of them. So I've broken the talk into three parts. The first part typically talks about logistics as an industry to give you a context. The second is about some of our products and how do we envision a data-driven AI platform. And the third part is some of the key takeaways based on my experience with delivery and some of my previous engagements working as a product manager with data and AI products. So let's get started. So what is the life cycle of a typical shipment in logistics? So consider an example. In Hyderabad, it's famous for pearls. And someone, let's say from Assam, orders pearls online. What is the life cycle? The order gets manifested. Somebody has to go to a seller's warehouse and from there, pick up the set of pearls, take it to a pickup center. Now just imagine, what are the kind of decisions that we need to take? Is the seller's warehouse open at a given time or not? While I'm showing a truck here, Begum Bazaar typically would not allow entry of trucks. Do I need to send a truck or a footer or a bicycle? Which pickup center should I send it to? Now, once I send it to a pickup center, it goes to our origin hub. Let's say somewhere near the airport. Now the next level of decision that I need to take is, should I send it into a truck or through a flight? And if it's a flash shipment and Amazon Prime, then I'll prefer a flight. But then there are some items that are not suited for flying. Now it reaches a destination hub. Continuing with the example of someone ordered it in Assam, it might go to Calcutta, and then from Calcutta, it might go to a local warehouse in Assam, which for our current discussion, let's call it a delivery center. And again, which delivery center does it need to go to, which is the closest to the customer? And then people on, again, bikes or trucks or vans, based on the shipment, based on the tax, takes it to finally your home and you get your set of pearls. So while I've told you certain decisions that have to be made, all these are intelligent decisions and we don't get all of this from customer directly. A lot of it has to be derived from data. And this is called the first mile, so I'll be using first mile, mid mile, and last mile. And most of the focus of this talk will be around the last mile platform, primarily because last mile, even if it's only the last 8 to 10 kilometers, is around 30 to 35% of the cost of a logistics industry shipment. And just imagine all these decisions have to be taken pan-India, where we deliver more than 500,000 to a lakh shipments, to a million shipments every day. So how do we think about a platform? So we have a set of algorithms, but then on the left side, we have operations that are running, which are continuously generating data for us. And on the right side, we are retraining our models, we are retraining our products to build intelligence on those products and keep improving them. As the platform matures, more and more parties get onboarded, the data becomes even better and our model accuracy becomes better, which eventually leads to optimization and better business outcomes. And a lot of it is based on location intelligence. And you might think that location intelligence is something that's already solved. Swiggy does it, Zomato does it, Uber, Ola, and a bunch of other companies. But let me just give you an example. I book a cab from my home, and this is a point that it detects automatically. With the circle that I'm showing you here is the error radius, so that this point can be anywhere within this error radius based on certain probabilities. And actually, the point is here. Now, when the driver comes in, this is the route that is expected out of the app, but then this part of the route doesn't have a road. So the driver calls me every time, and it takes around 5 to 10 minutes extra for the driver to arrive. It's a frustration for me. It's a frustration for the driver as well. Now, how do we deal with these uncertainties when we are talking about designing AI products and ML products? Because inherently, ML has certain precision, recall, and a certain degree of accuracy. And these are very India-specific challenges. My next slide talks about it. So I want you to look at what's written here, a couple of minutes. In the West, these problems doesn't occur because addresses are very, very well defined. You type in Google a complete house address and you'll get a rooftop geolocation where a driver can navigate to. But then, when Indian addresses get transliterated into English, this is what happens. Now, this is only one distance away from being Andheri East or Andheri West. And now this guy tries to be super, super helpful. Now, and believe me, these are actual addresses that we get. Now, the previous slide talks about using GPS data real time. But then the problem that we are solving is based on the address, trying to identify the geocode. Now, there's a Panwala or there's a second last address and Makan and then take a ride from there. He's super helpful, but our NLP models don't work like that. And now this guy had a very bad experience previously and he's in the address itself giving a threat that I want all products, otherwise I'll take some serious action, and he has some connections apparently with a police officer from Punjab or a CID officer rather. So we've built products, we are able to disambiguate certain aspects of these things by a product called AdFix. Now, given an address, this address will give you the exact geocode with a certain accuracy, and it gives you a bunch of other stuff, like whether the address is valid or not, or what is the hierarchy. Within India, it's in Delhi. Within Delhi, what's the locality? And then we use these models and share it with our client so that when an order gets manifested, they can use this intelligence to make sure that the addresses are entered correctly and there's no additional cost. But then if you look at this use case, works fine. But then if you look at it, the error radius is high. When I have to actually do the routing on the last mile, this pin is correct. But what if the actual pin is here, across this road? Now that becomes a challenge, and as we move forward, I'll talk more about that. And another issue is, how does the people on ground trust my algorithm? Because if I do a wrong routing a couple of times, these guys won't trust me. These guys will trust the address that's written here. And they'll say, I'll take a left from the second last makan. So moving on, and these are some of the challenges that are very India specific. And this slide talks about how we are thinking about the last mile of an AI platform. So the first part is the network planning part. Now, where do I locate my distribution centers based on a given load distribution? Now, while a model can predict where should a particular distribution center be, when you talk to your operations people, they'll say, okay, you've said on a particular geography, place it here, but there are no centers available. What do you do at that point? These are historical distributions or forecasts, which are inherently uncertain. So you can just give a recommendation, but there's no way to enforce and say, okay, this will be the best optimal solution. Once we've defined a particular load distribution by minimizing cost, enhancing productivity, making sure that the customer SLAs are met, then we have a product that takes care of the allocation monitoring and orchestration. It's called Player, which essentially stands for Field Executive Load Allocation and Routing Engine. And where once a shipment reaches to a distribution center, we allocate field executives which take that pearl set to your home. And then on top of that, we build a lot of intelligence on location, shipment. You remember, there was a news around soap bars or bricks being delivered in a mobile phone case. So we are able to predict that based on customer history, based on client history, based on the warehouse it's come from. Whether on a road a truck is allowed or not. A lot of location intelligence that we have, and we share it with our clients to make some real business impact and reduce costs. And all of that goes into our own delivery maps, the one that we saw in the previous slide. Now, what's very important is, if you look at this, this is a continuum. While these are individual products, there has to be a feedback system on the product and on the algorithm as well. Because while I've decided a certain cost when I'm planning the algorithm, there are uncertainties on the ground that might lead to additional cost or lesser productivity. So it has to go back to both the previous products so that it's continuously improving. And that is where the platform comes in, where on the right side, we had more and more participants on the platform. And on the left side, as we gain more data, the algorithms and the products keep improving. Now, let's look at the impact, the kind of impact we were able to have as delivery was able to disrupt the logistics industry. A typical logistic company works on a PIN code based routing. And PIN codes can be typically as long as big as 500 to 300 square kilometers, which essentially means if a shipment lands at a PIN code based distribution center, a person might need to travel 300 kilometers to deliver that shipment, which meant a particular field executive on the ground could only do 25 to 30 shipments in a given day. Basis ad fix and our prediction of locality, we were able to get that number up to 45 to 50 shipments, which means that you guys can get your shipments quicker and faster. Other things that we need to consider is utilization of FEs, the field executives, is maximum. The distance traveled is minimum. How does that impact us? It saves fuel cost, but it also has a lot of impact on our nature. With pollution levels rising, if you are able to reduce this percentage of distance traveled, it's a huge environmental saving. We need to ensure fairness, which is a hot topic in the AI and ML world. To give you an example, let's say somebody wants to deliver 50 shipments at an Infosys campus or an ISB campus. Comparatively easy, right? The guy comes in at the campus, calls a bunch of people, they come down and take shipments from you or deliver shipments to you. On the other hand, somebody goes to Old City, travels to multiple houses and delivers shipments. That is slightly more difficult. We need to design our incentives and routes in such a way that we ensure fairness. Now, what are the product challenges and how do we deal with uncertainty with an ML product? Now, this is how our operations team looks at routes. Very well defined, no uncertainty, 0 and 1. And this is what the data tells us. This is the actual locality, and these are all noises. So somebody who says near ISB might not be inside the ISB campus. But when we deliver, these points are collected from our mobile app. And just to give you a context, across the entire network, on a daily basis, we collect around 50 million geocodes with additional data tagged to it. And then based on this, our data science team is able to create these routes. Now there's a huge difference between what the operations is looking for and the routes that we are creating. The key challenge or the key question that we need to answer here is how to minimize the cost of true negatives and false positives. There will be true negatives, there will be false positives. But at the end of the day, the business benefit gained from the algorithm should be much, much higher, and that has to be quantified for our teams to build trust on our products. Now all that is okay, but in general, how do we think about AI products? So this is one example, and I've had other examples where I've worked with Hitachi and Boeing. And there's some common threads that I've been able to come up in terms of how to build or think about AI products in general. So the biggest challenge is there's a distribution in the input, there's a probabilistic output. A lot of people don't get that. Uncertainty is not very common. And this is something that you might be able to relate to. My algorithm will say, I am 95% confident that there's a 70% chance of rain. Okay, great. As a user, what I'll ask is, should I carry an umbrella or not? Okay, fair enough. Then my algorithm comes back and tells me, I can say with 80% confidence that the probability of you getting wet is 50% if you don't carry an umbrella. Okay, what should I do with it? Maybe it rained, but then you were inside a building. Maybe it rained, but you were inside a cab, so you didn't get wet. So it becomes very challenging to productize these kind of algorithms. So what I would recommend is try to evaluate the cost of all these true negatives and false positives. Another example. So my travel desk booked my flight, and this is not the flight that they booked. But Gmail tells me this is the flight that I need to board. It's on my calendar, and I'm not able to edit this. Now, I am a calendar guy. I look at my Outlook, and I see, oh my god, 6:25 flight. So if I would have not checked my ticket, this is what would have happened. And the reason this happened is they gave me three options, and the first option that was on the top got added to my calendar. What's the cost of it? Probably I would have missed this conference. Probably I can miss a business meeting. But then there is a lot of work still to be done to make sure that these things don't happen. Just adding a bit more context, we were talking about Flare, which is the load allocation and routing engine, the last mile of the platform. And how we thought about it is, let's say there's a cold start problem. We are entering into a new geography where we don't have any data. Now that's also, as data product managers, as machine learning or data scientists, people, we need to think about. So we give them a product where they define their routes manually. In about a month, we start giving recommendations using the same algorithm, using the same product. And then once we are confident on our products, we are confident on our algorithms, we start optimizing. So if you look at it, data collection, system recommendation, and optimization. Now, I'll leave you with a generic framework, and I found it useful in multiple products that I've used this. You might find it useful as well. So when you start a product, don't say that, okay, I don't have enough data. Only if I have data, then I'll be able to build a model. Work with your product managers, or even as data scientists, work with your business people and say, how can I collect good quality data? So this is your version one, not of the model maybe, but of the product, which is the data collection piece. Then you get to analytics assisted, which means you can give some editing options to make sure that the uncertainty is handled. Then you automate certain on-ground processes. Then you augment human intelligence. Now remember the previous example where a lot of ground executives' routes were manually created. Now, what is the kind of information that we get? We know when they create manual routes, they'll not cross a road which is highly traffic congested. They'll not cross a road which is, let's say, a flyover or a railway track, because it takes more time for them. So that is the place we can augment human intelligence, which will take a lot more data for us to get there. Now, once we have all of that and we are very confident on our models, only then we can go to what I call as artificially intelligent system. It can also be called as optimization problems, but then in my personal opinion, we aren't there yet as an ecosystem, because there are a lot of unknowns, a lot of unknown unknowns and a lot of known unknowns. So what are my key takeaways? Manage exceptions well. Make sure that the UI or the UX is intuitive, more from a user perspective. And as a community, it's our job. A lot of data scientists that I talk to are only restricted to precision and recall numbers. But it's our job to make sure that the product with whatever precision and recall that we have are usable. Because unless and until they are usable, we'll not be able to improve basis on ground feedback. Very important. The business benefits should far, far outweigh the cost of managing exceptions. Let's say I give a wrong prediction. Let's say the pulse shop was closed, my guy goes there, isn't able to pick up the pulse set. What's the cost of that? Versus if he's able to pick up, aggregate, and send it to a client in Assam. So we need to be very careful that the overall in the network, the business benefit far, far outweighs the cost and pain of managing exceptions. Define feedback loop for the product and the algorithm. Look at it separately, both are very important. Again, work with your operations, work with your product managers to make sure that you get this bit right. There are a lot of product metrics and feedback loops. NPS, customer satisfaction. But a lot of times we forget that the algorithm also needs a feedback loop so that we are able to trash ground realities. Define the right metrics, set the right expectations. Don't tell them, my model is going to change the world for you. Don't be afraid to say no. If something is not working, you've spent 3 months on it, great, but, and that is where ethics in AI comes in. You try to beat your data enough and then you try to say, okay, this will work, but your numbers are right, your training and testing set gives you good numbers, but eventually it fails on ground. Happens a lot of time. Even if you've spent 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, tell them it's not going to work out. At the end of the day, it was an experiment. That's why it's science and not a business rule. Understand the difference between AI and ML. Don't use them interchangeably. A lot of people I interview do that, and as soon as they do that, okay, I'm out of the room. And it's not the end of the world yet. We still have a lot of time to go. A lot of journeys still need to be done. Thank you.